Hello, everyone, and welcome. Oh, mask. Welcome to episode 20 of Fairfield Center Couch. Can you believe it? Episode 20 already. I know, just seems like, oh, God, months ago we started this, right? And here we are back again. Even though quarantine, we are starting to see some reopening in Connecticut. We are still doing this once a week for you on Tuesdays, every Tuesday at 6 p.m. My name is Brian Bish. I am the media manager of Fairfield Center Stage, and I'm excited to bring some guests to you tonight. We are bringing back some people who were here before and also some brand new guests starting off the evening. Actually, I'm jumping around with some other things. Before I do that, I want to show you, we have some merch for Fairfield Center Stage. You may have seen it by now, the Fairfield Center Couch. Let's hit that video for littleshopofbroadway.com. See what you can get from us. Okay, as you see, you are able to get any of those items on littleshopofbroadway.com. The link right here. Go to the page and scroll down to the very bottom. There's a section that says our favorite clients, and there is Fairfield Center Stage. You can order the glitter hoodies, the glitter t-shirts, the regular t-shirts. We have Rocky Horror Lips masks. For the Rocky Horror masks, $2 of each sale goes back to Fairfield Center Stage. So you can go there and order your own apparel today and join in that. It's also support a great cause for Little Shop of Broadway. Karen is great. She's made a lot of merch for us, and we want to support her business as well during everything. So now, so let's bring on our first guest we have for the evening. I'm going to bring up here and welcome Jenny and Laura Silence. How are you, ladies?
We're good. How are you?
I'm great. So where are you quarantining tonight from?
We're at our house in Fairfield, really.
Right.
A bunch of the venues from Center Stage.
Yep, and we're in Jenny's bedroom.
Yeah, we're in my bedroom.
Perfect. How's quarantine going for you so far?
It's been good. It's been boring. I miss being on stage.
But right, you had what would have been a big opening night. It would have happened recently.
Yeah,
what was that for?
I was supposed to play Mary in Peru and the Music Man at Fairfield Prep. Would have opened a little over 2 weeks ago, May 7th. So yeah, that was a really big disappointment. But my castmates and I, every Thursday, every week, we come together and we do short plays on Zoom together, and that's been really great. So that's
great. Are you doing that for others to watch, or just for yourselves to get together and have a good time?
We do them for ourselves, and then we had a day where we did it for the prep community. It was like a community day, arts and ideas, and we all performed live for, it was like 200 people. It was really, really exciting. Yeah.
That's fantastic. I love that. You know, it's interesting times right now. We're changing everything and shifting things around to do performances differently.
Yeah. It's going to be really exciting to see that, like, even just this, having the Fairfield Center Couch is just an amazing way to keep connected, you know, and that's what's so great about Fairfield Center Stage is its focus on the community, right? And that's what's so important right now, is that we're all in our own places, but that we all stay connected and that we celebrate the arts, which is what Center Couch is doing, which is great.
Exactly, because it's so difficult. I mean, I know you're like me, that you need to be out there doing things and be out there. And also like me, I haven't left the house. You're in the same situation, right?
Yep, no, I have not been in a building besides my home since March 13th. Right.
Yeah. Exactly. I've gone out for a few drives just to see the outside world. But other than that, everything's being delivered and just staying in and waiting this through. To change. So, of course, Jenny, you have done several shows with us. How many have you done? Do you know what? Right off the top of your head.
I mean, I was in Hunchback that Christy directed. That was my first show.
Right.
Christy and Eli. And then I was in Christmas Carol last year and this year. I played Martha Cratchit, and I had a slight appearance as Belle for one performance. And then my kind of like big thing, I guess, is I was Martha in The Secret Garden, which was like the craziest thing to me that I got to do that. So like, I, I got asked to audition for the role. Like, I went in and was like, okay, like, yeah, this will be fun. I'm not expecting anything from it because I had played like children's roles kind of in these other shows. And then I was sitting doing my homework on my desk and Christy called me and I could not believe it was the craziest thing that ever happened to me.
I remember that audition. I was there for that. So I remember that. How was that experience of performing that role talk to us all about where we did the show for those who may not know.
We performed at the Pequot Library in Southport, which is one of the most beautiful places I've ever got to perform. Like the decorations and the set was, and the costumes were so beautiful. And like getting to be in that cast, like we all still like talk to each other, like it was the most supportive, talented group of people like I've ever gotten to work with. It was crazy. Like it's still surreal to me.
Well, we have some photos of that. Can we see a couple of pictures of you from Secret Garden having come in this way for us?
Oh,
there you are with little Miss Nikki. Yes.
That's my favorite.
That's Nikki too, right?
That's your favorite there? I love that one. Mm-hmm. And there's where you're just letting it all out, belting Face in the Lawn, because act two, we took it outside into the garden. So act two, we went outside, which was
a big number. I thought, yeah, it was
just a magical experience with act one inside and act two outside, which is always fun because for Fairfield Center Stage, we're used to theater and doing things differently, not having our own home and traveling around for where the show makes sense. Some more love coming in for you here.
Yeah.
Uncle Michael and Uncle Greg saying, I love that. Now, Laura,
yeah.
you have, of course, everyone may recognize you from being around the theater, but you are on the Board of Representatives.
I am. So I became a board member because I was so inspired by what Christine, Eli, and you and the whole team have been doing. My first experience was watching Music Man on the Green, which I was completely floored by. I was like, how? It was like, these people said that they were going to do a show, and then they did a show, and they had so much talent, and they made it appear in downtown Fairfield. It was incredible. And then you guys went on, and doing the site specific, again, just completely blew me away. I've done a lot of theater. I have a big theater background, but the can-do attitude and then the combined with the quality of the work was so incredibly inspiring. And then Jenny got to do Christmas Carol at Burr Mansion, which was magical again and so cool. And it's one of my favorite stories. So that was super fun. And then we saw Dreamgirls. Like I just started to say, who are these people who make all of this happen? And then Jenny was in Secret Garden and I started to get involved and volunteer a little bit.
And then you became one of the people to make it happen.
And then I came on board to try to help support them. It's kind of as my background in fundraising in that it's really important to support the arts. And again, like so an organization like Fairfield Center Stage, it's so can do, it's born out of people who live here and are raising their kids here. And they give opportunities to my kids and children all over the place and adults to be able to kind of show who they are, that it's important to support them and find ways to be able to ask for money and to have people support the nonprofit that we are.
Absolutely. Especially right now with in the times of everything that's going on in the world, every organization out there is really going through it. And we are a nonprofit theater company. So if people are watching this today, if you're able to support us, you can do so by texting a donation to us. Text FCS Dream to 41411, and you can make a donation to support Fairfield Center Stage. And we would really appreciate it if you're able to, or even spreading the word, because everything you do right now can really help support the organization. We'll talk about that more later on. But also, so you have been, Laura, helping with the board, you've helped backstage with shows. Like I mentioned, you became one of the people who makes things happen. Yeah. And you've also been on stage for us before too.
I have.
She's going, wait a second.
I forgot.
It was a year ago yesterday. Can you believe it? The play-a-thon was 1 year ago yesterday. Our play-a-thon, we do this every year, and it's a 26-hour festival of energy and creativity, where plays and musicals are written, performed, written, rehearsed, and performed within 26 hours. And you were in the cast for one of the performances last year, which
was awesome. That was the first time that I've been on stage in a really long time.
And how was that?
I almost wore that same shirt today, so I'm really glad I did.
You could have just said you were wearing it for the anniversary. No one would have known.
Right.
Any idea.
But like that, the play festival is so much fun. My husband was involved. Jenny was like, we were all.
My dad directed me in that.
Yes, absolutely. You had almost the entire family. When are we going to have everyone? When's that happening?
Next time we do it, we'll get
okay.
We'll get them in.
Yeah.
Huh. If only we do a play-a-thon, we'll see what happens.
Okay.
Hmm. All right. So anyhow, Jenny, you have a song for us, right?
I do. We're getting a little, we're bringing the Yorkshire back today.
Oh, yes. Let's hear the song, and then we'll come back to you as Laura and talk as well, but I'd love to hear the song. For those who saw Secret Garden, what song are you doing today?
I'm going to be singing Hold On, which is my kind of big number from the Secret Garden, and the message is perfect, because in the scene, my character, who was kind of Mary, the main character, she was like her kind of best friend. She was her chambermaid. She was her supporter. And this number happens right after Mary tells her that she's going to give up and that she's going to leave. And she's just going to stop caring about all of these things she's been trying to do. And I think that right now, with everyone kind of feeling so down and like there's not really knowing what the future holds, that it's important to remember to hold on.
Perfect setup. All right, take it away.
What you've got to do is finish what you have begun. I don't know just how, but it's not over till you've won. When you see the storm is coming, see the lightning part the skies. It's too late to run. There's terror in your eyes. What you do then is remember this old thing you heard me say. It's the storm, not you, that's bound to go away. Hold on to someone standing by. Hold on, don't even ask how long, why. Child, hold on to what you know is true. Hold on till you get through. Child, oh child, hold on. When you feel your heart is pounding, if there are devils at your door, it's too late to hide. You're frozen to the floor. What you do then is you force yourself to wake up and you say, it's this dream, not me, that's bound to go away. Hold on, the night will soon be gone. Hold on, and think of something else to try. Child, hold on, there's angels on their way. Hold on and hear them say, child, oh child, and it doesn't even matter if the danger and the doom come from up above or down below or just come flying at you from across the room. When you see a man who's raging and he's jealous and he fears that you watch the walls he's been behind for years. What you do then is you tell yourself to wait it out and say, it's this day, not me, that's bound to go away. Child, hold on, it's this day, not you, that's bound to go away.
Yes. Oh my God. I can just hear the applause out there. That was so, so good. I love that song so much. And you always do such a beautiful, beautiful job with it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us. Got some love coming in for you. And you set that up perfectly because it's such an important message of the song for everything that's happening right now, how we can really try and support each other and be there for each other. And Laura, back to you a little bit. Let's talk about what you do whenever you're not involved with Fairfield Center Stage for work, how you've been supporting people and helping people.
I'm a high school counselor. So I've been really busy during this time. It's, you know, it's been heartbreaking for me. You know, students, you know, I have students that are Jenny's age and they've missed their school shows, their spring sports. And my job is to keep them you know, inspired to keep doing their schoolwork. And it's kind of hard sometimes, you know. I feel, you know, I want to like turn off the computer and go crawl it back into bed. So it's been a lot. Like it takes a lot of energy. And I got to tell you, for anybody who's a teacher out there, like the teachers are doing an amazing job.
Absolutely.
And the parent, I got to say, parents are doing an amazing job homeschooling, you know, not homeschooling, but, you know, helping with the distance learning. Like my heart goes out to all the parents too, because I know that how difficult it is for them. So it's been a, you know, again, back to community and being positive and supportive of each other. That's my role.
All she's been doing. She's a mom and a teacher, which is amazing. I'm like right next door and I hear her like speaking Spanish to parents and doing all of these like amazing things. It's really
basically mom and teacher are both words that mean superhero. So that's a double superhero right there, honestly. So thank you for everything that you were doing. It's just wonderful to hear about, especially with all of the difficult times going on, of hearing some good things coming out of it and how, again, we are hanging on to support each other to get through everything. So for to move to the next guest, I'm going to bring on someone that you know, of course, or a couple people that you know. Jenny, you have shared a stage with them, and here we are.
Welcome. Hi, Jenny.
Hi. Hi.
How are you doing?
Hanging in there.
Yeah.
Holding on.
The correct answer is yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Is day number what?
75.
Day 75. I know. And you have been on the couch with us before here for Fairfield Center Couch. You were on one of the second or third episodes?
Yeah, one of the early episodes.
You were on very early. We didn't even have all the photos and the banners and the pop-ups and things.
No glitter hoodies.
StreamYard.
There was no merch.
There was no merch.
We had a
We feel like trailblazers.
Absolutely. So you came back today to do something a little bit different. So again, you were in Secret Garden together, of course, part of the cast here. Mm-hmm. How was the experience working together? Look at this. I love these shots.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah, it was something we've been dying to do.
Yeah, I think we've been trying to plant that seed in Christy's head for like 5 or 6 years before it was chosen. And that's one of my two or three absolute bucket list roles. And to be able to do it with, you know, my wife and some of my best friends at the same time, I mean, there's not much more you can ask for.
Right. And those photos of you are gorgeous. Kate Eisman, our company photographer, took those. Yeah. You had stunning shots, the promo shots, all the shots of you two together were just so, so good. And there were wonderful ones. Of course, the ones earlier of Jenny were also, Kate took those as well. Yeah. So we are going to give Jenny and Laura, we're going to let you go and hang in the background for a little while, but don't go away because we're going to bring you back later on. We found out last night, so a little teaser for everyone watching. Last night we were doing a little test run of this, and they were talking about Broadway trivia and things they've been doing to pass the time. So we're like, hey, why don't we do Broadway trivia today? So we're going to do that at the end of the broadcast. So hang around. You don't want to miss that. We're going to bring Jenny and Laura back for some trivia. And they'll be playing against Betsy and Ben. More to come on that. All right. So I'm going to pop you in the back then. Jenny and Laura, hang up back there. And Betsy and Chris, hi again.
Hi again.
So you mentioned day 75. Still hanging in. What's changed? Has anything changed since last time?
More screen time for the kids.
More hair. More grays. Hair.
Yep.
Definitely. Yep.
Yeah. It's just like I'm. For me, it's like 75 days without daycare. That's really what it is. It's not like 75 days in quarantine. It's 75 days without daycare. But I don't know. I think we're like starting to make it work.
Well, I think you fall into a groove at some point and you have routines and, you know, it starts to become second nature. And you get very used to the fact that this is kind of your new normal. At the same time, a swelling appreciation for the people that have taken care of our kids up to this point.
Yeah. Oh,
because
my God.
You cannot in any way undersell, you know, what the teachers have been doing, what the child care providers do, because trying to do it yourself while working, I can't imagine. I give them props and we are so grateful for them. And I can't wait to send them back, to be honest. Take my kids, please.
Please take them. Oh my gosh, that's wonderful. So you got a new purchase for Aaron's birthday, right?
Yeah,
that's right.
That was a we were like, oh, we should definitely get Aaron a trampoline for his birthday.
Because who doesn't need a trampoline right now?
Yeah. And I was like, it's good to get some outside, to get some, you know, and then the boxes came, and it came in like two boxes. And I turned to Chris and I was like, this is not going to be a cool surprise. Like if it's just in these two boxes. And so I was like, do you think we can put this together after he goes to sleep? And Chris was like, are you crazy? And then he's like, yeah.
So let's do it. We documented it. I think she documented it over Instagram. Over two nights, we built the trampoline in secret in the driveway in the garage. And then the night before his birthday, I pulled my Jeep onto the grass and lit the area where we're going to put the trampoline up. And we just built it in the dark. And he woke up the next morning and saw it with balloons tied to it. And the reaction was that made it worthwhile.
Yeah, if you didn't see it on Instagram, this was not a tiny trampoline. This isn't like a little one person bounce situation. How big is that thing?
It's 12 foot diameter. Yeah.
It's a small casual trampoline. There we go. Oh, I think I lost your sound for 1 second. Oh no, you're good. You're back. It could be mine. The joy of live theater and live broadcasting. You never know what happens. All right, so we have to go and project that. So, talking about the trampoline, you did a little performance. We were talking with you about what song you wanted to do today, and it took a very different direction in the past 24 hours, right?
Yeah.
Well, Christy reached out to us, I think, about a week or two ago. I was like, hey, guys, what do you think about singing on the trampoline? And I looked at Betsy like, this woman is cuckoo bananas. And then we decided as we got closer to the day, we'll figure out something. We can make it work. So something a little bit different than kind of the park and bark into the screen that we did last time.
So I think the initial thought, we were kind of curious to see what it would be like just for you bouncing on the trampoline trying to sing, but it turned into something much bigger, which was just amazing. So let's go ahead. Look how that started. So this isn't going to be a live performance, but let's go ahead and roll the video. This happened, again, within the past 24 hours. You shot this morning?
Laid the track last night, shot the video this morning, and edited it, like, mid-afternoon, and sent it to you by 2, I think.
I had it by 2 o'clock.
We'll be pitching to the studio soon.
Yeah.
Perfect. All right, so let's go ahead and roll that video.
Different in the woods, more sure, more sharing. You're getting us through the woods. If you could see, you're not the man who started, and much more open-hearted than I knew you to be.
It takes two. I thought one was enough, it's not true. It takes two of us, you came through. When the journey was rough, it took you. It took two of us, it takes care. It takes patience and fear and despair to change. Though you swear to change, who can tell if you do? It takes two.
You've changed. You're thriving. There's something about the woods, not just surviving. You're blossoming in the woods. At home, I'd fear we'd stay the same forever. And then out here, you're passionate, charming, considerate, clever.
Take one to begin, but then once you've begun, takes two of you, it's no fun. But what needs to be done, you can do. When there's two of you, if I dare, it's because I'm becoming aware of us. As a pair of us, each accepting a share of what's there.
We've changed, we're strangers. I'm meeting you in the woods. Who minds what danger?
strangers. I know you past the woods, and once we're past, let's hope the changes last. Beyond woods, beyond witches and slippers and hoods, just the two of us, beyond lies, safe at home with our beautiful prize. Just a few of us, it takes trust. It takes just a bit more and we're done. We want four, we had none, we got three. We need one, it takes two.
Yes. Oh, that was just amazing. I love it so much. And especially at the end, 75 days in quarantine. You could all hear. Wait, hold on. I feel like I should have had my sound effects ready. I wasn't planning, but. There we go. 75 days. Ah, Rachel, hi. Hello, how are you? So, we know what's been, you know, you were very busy with everything before, and not a lot's changed since the last time. So let's go ahead and bring on Ben and talk with Ben a little bit. So Chris, you can have a little bit of a break if you want,
yeah, with
Ben, and then we're gonna come bring you back into play with us in a moment. So, Ben, how
hey,
are
everyone.
You?
Oh, matching siblings.
Matching siblings.
We only ever wear always black tees. Just me and Ben.
Always.
Yeah,
I mean that's fair. If not black for me, it's glitter, and today I have both. So completely fair. For those of you who don't know, Ben, of course, is Betsy's brother. But Ben,
groups to Broadway to see different shows, and then finally dynamic ticket pricing. So the easiest way to describe that is, like, you know, on the airlines and hotels, the prices are always changing. Now Broadway has gotten into that, so we get hired by specific Broadway shows to go in and change the pricing on a daily, hourly basis. So unfortunately, things are a little slow and up in the air right now. We're staying optimistic. You know, obviously we need it to be safe, and that's the number one priority. But it's been so nice to come home to Connecticut and be with my family. For usually I'm the one that will escape on the weekends and just come like Friday through Sunday to see my nephew and my dog. And now it's looking like a nice 6-month vacation in Connecticut.
Hanging around a little bit.
Yeah. So, you know, and focusing and doing all these remote readings and trying to stay up to date with, you know, the theater community has been a big learning curve of, you know, everything going virtual. We're so used to doing everything live and being with each other. And now it's just completely shifted a bit. Yeah.
What has your experience with shifting to a virtual platform? What's that the experience been for you so far?
You know, it's been really interesting. There's kind of been like two camps of people, and what I like to preface it with, like, there's no right way you should be going through a quarantine, but we're having, you know, these busy bees and creative people that are like, let's do a Zoom reading every week, let's do, you know, these living room, and then there's the other camp that's a little more like, I like live theater and I don't really want to do this virtual stuff because it's not, you know, we're not used to it and things like that. So it's been interesting to just see that give and take. And I think now that we're settling into quite a long time, everything's going to have to shift more to that. We have to stay creative. We have to keep our projects going because this isn't just a little few weeks. You know, this will be kind of the new normal. And I think a positive thing is it's going to set up a lot of protocols now, you know, in the future where we can stream things and reach more and more people. I was just listening actually to the radio today and they were like, you know, snow days in schools might not be snow days anymore because now they're set up to do virtual teaching. If it snows, they're set up. And I was like, But I was like, for Broadway, it's like, you know, maybe God forbid if a show gets canceled because it's an early preview or there's sickness and they can't go on, maybe there's some virtual thing they can send to the, you know, the audience members or do something. So there's going to be a new way about going about the business, I think, which is really exciting.
It's very interesting. For Fairfield Center Stage, it's been a different experience for us. We started doing these broadcasts for Fairfield Center Couch thinking, you know, it was just going to be for a little while. We didn't know how long it was going to be. No one did. And here we are in episode 20 and going, oh my gosh, now it's turned into an actual thing.
Yeah, and it's something everyone can look forward to and keep your community engaged because they're the ones that are going to have to come back and be as supportive when we can all be together again.
Exactly. And we had a show we were supposed to perform Wit We were in rehearsals. It had our tech was over, and we were going to be opening on March 12th or 13th, whatever the Friday was, because time no longer exists in quarantine. Yeah, it every time. It's no longer a thing. But we were opening WIT, and it was pulled because we had to postpone and delay. But that is now happening this Saturday. We're doing WIT this Saturday, a virtual performance that we're using the StreamYard platform. It'll be on YouTube for a private link. 7 p.m. So that's something people are going to be able to tune in to join. They can get tickets now. Tickets are available on fairfieldcenterstage.org. It's just one of the ways that we're adapting for FCS to be able to change. It wouldn't work for every show, but for this show, it made sense. It worked out as a cast of people. It wouldn't be able to translate for every type of show. For this one, we were lucky. So it's awesome. It's interesting to see how are things looking. I mean, of course, you can't say about specifics because, again, no one knows. But what's the feeling right now in the Broadway community?
You know, I think the first thing they had to establish was, you know, can you socially distance in a theater? And I think now with all the brainstorming and everything, the answer is no, because it's, you know, first you're worrying about the audience, you know, those old theaters, all the seats are on top of each other. And then the ushers and the, you know, the whole front of house. So there's so much contact there. And then you have to think about the safety of the actors. And it's like, you know, in the chorus ensemble dressing rooms, there's 12 people to this little room. And, you know, so there's no, you could do the temperature checks and you could do everything, but then you get the performance and like there's kissing and touching and dancing and sweating. So it doesn't, and then the whole separate part of that is the financial model, which, you know, a fun trivia thing is like one out of four shows that you see on Broadway will make their money back and be considered a hit. And that's taking into account, you have to sell every ticket at a, you know, a high ticket price just to make the business model work. So it's reducing to 50% capacity or 30% capacity just doesn't work, you know, with the numbers and the model. So that's kind of the exciting thing, I think, looking in the future with these unions and all these, there will be an opportunity to see how can we strengthen this financial model going forward, because shows are so expensive to run. But I think we're kind of in this waiting period now where we need to make sure 1,000, 1,500 people feel safe to all go see the same show. So I think, you know, and it's so funny, the Broadway League has like 20 to 30 different task forces. So marketing and ticketing and health and unions, just keeping the ball rolling and continuing the conversations. But I do think it's going to be 2021 when we can all get back.
Maybe
And learning, and hopefully, I think the other thing was learning, hopefully regional theaters off Broadway, maybe some of the touring markets can open first and kind of learn, not from their mistakes, but see what's working, what's not working, so that Broadway can kind of be last. I would hate for Broadway to open too soon and then something doesn't go well and then it has to close again. Like, that would be horrible. So just making sure everything is set up to rebound as strong as ever.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now, don't think for a second, I know we're talking a lot about what you're doing, but don't think for a second that you could come on to Fairfield Center Couch and we wouldn't have photos of you as well.
I know who to blame. There's probably a few.
Well, there's a couple people to blame. One's next to you and the other one is me. I'm really good at stalking people on Facebook.
Uh-oh. So
you're welcome.
Here we go.
We have a couple.
There's one.
You want to tell us about this night? Was this
was the band's visit winning the Tony Award, and that was super fun. So the year before was actually Hello Dolly, which was my first, which was so fun. So I brought my parents, and another fun fact, tickets to sit downstairs, where if you're a co-producer and you think your show is going to win and you want to go on stage, you want to be downstairs. Tickets are like $1,700. So I surprised my parents, and I was like, and that was the year it was Hello Dolly and Falsettos. There were two nominees. So I'm talking about not that picture, but anyway, so basically the year before I won, and it was super exciting, and we kind of had a great feeling because there were only two nominees. But that picture was Band's Visit, super exciting, did it again. And it was so fun because it was the year, I don't know if everyone remembers, it was like SpongeBob, Band's Visit, Mean Girls. There were like these three or four movie musicals and then Band's Visit. And you know, I adored the Band's Visit, so I got a part of it, but I have friends that say to my face, that was the most boring, worst show I've ever seen. It was one of the first times it was so polarizing, where the critics and the Tony nominators, everyone just really got the piece of art, and then the general public didn't really get it. but it was so fun to be in the audience because I think it was nominated for, I'm going to mess it up, like 12 Tony nominations, and it won 11. It was just, it just won. It started early in the night winning things. Oh my God. Oh, that's a little, so I brought, yeah, I brought the other one home. It was in New York and I was like, I gotta look at them together. It was so fun because early in the night it was winning things like lighting design that wasn't expected. And then we were like, this is going to be a fun night. But won, I think, 11 of the 12 awards it was up for. And that's my producing partner, Joe Longthorne, who we met in college. We both went to school for musical theater, and then, you know, performed for a few years out of school, but then kind of got bit by the business side of it. Yeah. It's so funny. He was in, when I really decided I wanted to be a producer, was I was directing senior year of college, and I was directing Bat Boy. Christy, if you ever want to do Bat Boy, now I'm home and I live in Connecticut, so I want to direct.
Place for the, for Christy and Eli.
Yeah, we could do it like in a cave 6 feet apart, like I'm an attic or something. We'll figure it out. But he was in that production, and we just became really close friends. And he, after college, I decided to like produce the show at the festival level, and he was performing and was like, hey, can I come join you and help? I'll work for free. And we had such a blast working together. We were like, we can do this for a living. We can line produce and make these shows happen. And we've, you know, been business partners. That's Millie. We've been business partners now for, I think, 5-6 years. Awesome.
That's fantastic. What's your point? I mean, obviously the Tonys, but what are some of your favorite memories of that time, of the experiences?
Oh my gosh, there were so many. I think it really started, Waitress was the first big one where I had seen the show in Boston just as a fan. And, you know, for Sarah Bareilles and Jesse Mueller, and Joe was in Japan, and I called him. I was like, we've got to figure out a way how to produce this show, get involved. So Joe's roommate at the time was this well-known music director on Broadway. He's like, I know the lead producers. I'll just call the Weislers and see. And I was working in a theater office in the city and asking all the, you know, my mentors. They're like, no, they've raised all their money. Like, there's no way. There's no way. And we got an email that was like, yep, Barry Weisler wants to talk to you at 5 o'clock. And then he called. And that was like, I was like, oh my God, Barry Weisler's calling me. What do we do? And he was like, yeah, sure. There's one spot left. You guys can, you have to raise a lot of money, which was not easy. But that was really thrilling to be like, you know, and something I tell, you know, all our students and stuff, that it's like, that only happened because we asked. Like, if there's one lesson, it's like, you just have to ask. The worst that he could have said is like, no, we raised our money a year ago. Sorry, I'll think about you for next time, you know? But a lot of, you know, making my own business and, you know, getting the opportunities has been from just like going to do it. I remember, you know, asking this veteran producer, well, how do we produce? How do we get involved? Like early on, he was like, you go to a producer and say you can raise money and then you become a producer. And we're like, oh, okay, I guess that's what we'll do, you know? So working on Waitress was really thrilling. And that was a show, it was the year of Hamilton, where, you know, pitching it to investors was like, it's not going to win Best Musical. It might run a year, but like, I don't know. I think Sarah Bareilles is, you know, and it just caught on and ran for almost 5 years. It was like 4 years. And it was so fun to see all the different casting and people come in. So that was a blast. And the other one that I near and dear to my heart was Oh Hello, which it was this Nick Kroll and John Mulaney. It's actually on Netflix. You can watch it. It's a fun quarantine comedy. So just laugh and laugh. But I was working in the office and as a co-producer, so I got to really be hands-on with the lead producer. And that's where that kind of started the ticketing thing, because these were these comedy buyers all of a sudden coming to Broadway. And then, oh, and Hello Dolly. I mean, winning that Tony, I'll never forget Bette Midler. I randomly got right behind her and she grabbed my hand and right after one. And I was like, congrats. And she was like, congrats to all of you. And I was like, I'm not going to wash my hand for
you. Said that last time.
I was like, I just remember going off stage and my mom and dad were there and they hugged me. And I was like, Bette Midler held my hand. Did you touch?
Yeah. Mom, dad, can you not touch this hand right now?
Yeah, this is reserved now for Bette Midler. So many. Yeah. So it's just been such a fun ride. And then, you know, this past year, so co-producing is, you have more of a backseat. There's these lead producers that kind of run the day to day and you help find all the money and then get to go to some ad meetings and give some input. But like, we've really transitioned now to focusing on, you know, developing new work. And it was a huge highlight this past year. Someone we went to college with wrote this play that, you know, was sitting in our inbox forever. Joe finally read it and was like, we have to do this play. And, you know, we got it. It got picked up off Broadway by some nonprofit, Second Stage and Women's Project. And then we helped, you know, enhance it. And it was such a hit. It got the New York Times Raven. We were able, supposed to run 5 weeks and it ran like 16, which is crazy for an off-Broadway show. So that was our first time as lead producers really doing the day-to-day and like developing new work from the ground up. So that's super been a highlight this year.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Kind of like look to the future. We don't know what's going to happen. What do you think are the best ways that we could try to really support Broadway as?
Yeah, I mean, just what you're doing, you know, that buy the hoodie, go see Wit, you know, these community theaters and nonprofits. I mean, I'm in the commercial world, but especially the nonprofits where they're so seasonally based and they get all their donations coming in, you know, from their audience members, they're losing, you know, a whole year of that. So the biggest priority is, I know everyone's asking for money, my inbox is just overflowing, but it's being able to support the arts so that, you know, when it comes back, it can come back, because I would hate to see after all of this, we come back and you're hearing about your favorite theater, just can't even find the money to produce a show, which is going to be really tricky. So when you hear that Broadway's coming back in January or March or whenever it is, go bring your family and buy a ticket, obviously safely. Hopefully by then we know it's safe to do so. But yeah, supporting the stuff you loved before all this nonsense happened. Yeah.
Definitely. It's safe to get back. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Perfect. All right. Well, talking about Broadway again, I'm going to bring Jenny and Laura back in to join us because the challenge last night. I don't know who started this or which way it went, but hi there,
Jenny,
ladies.
Laura, I'm nervous. They're the pros.
I think I brought it up, and I'm like, as soon as I said it, I'm like, I'm way out.
No, I'm keeping my confidence, but
I need your confidence because like, this will be embarrassing when I don't know anything.
Well. Betsy and Ben, what would you say are your strong points as far as Broadway trivia? What would you feel your strengths are? What areas do you think you know better?
I would say that, you know, the contemporary shows for sure. All these leading ladies, you know, I'm always going to pick like a Jessie Mueller, Audra McDonald.
I'm classic.
She's like Rodgers and Hammerstein and stuff, which is good. And then flops for some reason. Like I love these obscure shows. I had such a string of all my favorite shows growing up were the shows that ran. Both performances.
All right.
So,
and Jenny and Laura, same question for you. What do you feel? What are your strengths?
I think definitely contemporary for me, and I'm also like, I'm a Sutton Foster and also Jeremy Gordon. I'm obsessed. So, I think if there's questions like that, I'll definitely be able to get them pretty quickly.
And I'm definitely more old school, like you know, like 80s, 70s, Andrew Lloyd Webber.
So it's good we got like one on each team. It'll be good.
All right. Now you do, each of you can phone a friend. By phone a friend, we mean yell across the room. So Chris is there to support Betsy and Ben. And we have Mark in the background there to support Laura and Jenny, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
All right. So you feel free to reach out to them as you need to. As far as Facebook, don't worry because we have a small delay, like 15 seconds till we get to Facebook. So they can't help you. People can comment. So we're going to start off for Broadway trivia. We should have had a theme song for this, but we don't, so I have the shade button.
Oh.
All right. So we're going to start off with title role and see how these go, okay? So to buzz in, what I want you to do, how are we going to buzz in? Just
raise your hand
in the air if you know the answer, and don't answer until I call on you because Christy's going to be in the background helping me see who raised their hand first. All right. So if you're ready to answer, the first question is who originated these title roles on Broadway? Who originated the title role in the Tina Turner musical? Oh. Ben.
Adrienne Warren, who should get Tony this month, but next year she's so good. If you haven't seen Tina, go buy a ticket for Tina when it comes back.
When Tina's back, when you see. So that's one for Betsy and Ben. All right. So who originated the title role for Aladdin?
Oh.
Ben?
Go ahead.
Adam Jacobs.
I was going to say Jacobs.
Yeah. Okay. You got to get the next one.
All right. That's correct. Who originated the title role for Hello, Dolly?
Channing.
Reason.
Laura.
Channing.
Carol.
Carol Channing.
I'm sorry, you didn't say who is.
Okay.
You got the point.
Fun fact on that. It was offered to Ethel Merman, who turned it down.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I knew that. Wow.
Carol Channing.
All right, let's go for a different one. Who originated the title role for Mary Poppins?
Oh, this is a trick one.
On Broadway? On Broadway, right? We're talking about Broadway.
Oh, I know. I know who it is. You know. Ashley Brown.
Yes.
That's correct.
Yeah.
No, I didn't correct.
I love her.
She's so good.
Yeah.
She's so talented.
Let's see. Who originated the title role for The Phantom of the Opera? Laura.
Michael Crawford.
That is correct.
Cat Cam.
There we go. Kitty Cam. And we'll do one more. Who originated the title role for Annie? Christy, I'm going to see who the call is for that. She says Betsy.
Andrew McCardle.
That is correct. All right, so
That's our favorite show of all time.
That is our favorite show of all time.
I would have been really upset if we didn't get the winning. It's the only one I needed to get right tonight.
What's the score so far, Christy? Can you pop that into the notes here? We're going to see who we have.
Four and the Silences with two.
Ooh. All right.
We got to get to some good tiebreakers. So we got to lose. Yeah.
Oh, no, that's just one category. We have more categories. Now we're going to move into... see, how many of these poorly deciphered lyrics can you decipher? We're going to show you something on the screen. Actually, I think I'll pop this up, Kristen, make it a little bit easier on that one. I'm going to pop up some lyrics on the screen, and you have to decipher them and say the actual lyrics. Yes, please.
This is a Playbill quiz, and I loved it. These lyrics were put into Google Translate. So they're like poorly translated lyrics, and you have to decipher what it actually means.
Okay.
Oh, gosh. Okay.
Okay. So let's see. We have, I'm going to put it on the screen. Are you ready? This. I want to eat with my baby tonight, and tonight I will have my baby and puppy, but even today I didn't have a child. Too hot. Okay. Betsy, let's hear it. We have to get them all right, though.
Okay.
You got to get the whole lyric?
I want to stop with my baby tonight and be the pup with my baby tonight. Something that you had to say, but it's too darn hot.
Okay, that was not the lyric. Do you want to steal?
No.
I can't give you the point for that one. You were in the right direction, but you didn't have it all completely right.
So close.
I'd like to sup with my baby tonight and play the pup with my baby tonight, but I ain't up to my baby tonight because it's too darn hot.
Very close.
These are tough.
I kind of like Google Translate.
I do the show and the song.
All right. So moving to the next one, we have This Is Not a Great Life. Draw a banner through this.
This is hard.
Whoa.
My mind immediately went to Newsies, but I don't think.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
You are in the right area, yes. Run with that. Run with it.
Oh, it's a fine life carrying the banner.
Which lyric are we going for?
It's a fine life.
Carrying a banner through the
stall. Close. Keep going.
A mighty fine life carrying the banner, tough and tall.
Oh, so close. These are really tough.
It's a fine life carrying the banner through it all.
Ain't it a fine life carrying the banner through it all? That was very, very close. I'm only going to do one more of these because these are extremely tough.
And these are so hard. Christy, these are hard.
She is not playing with it. So let's see. This one is... Remember that there was a before. If you go back to or means or before, now I got it, and it's time to leave the forest.
Oh.
Think it through. Let's see the hand when you're ready. Betsy's hand is up. Let's hear it.
Remembering you've had an and when you're back or makes the or mean more than it did before. Now I understand, and it's time to leave the woods.
You got it. Wow.
Have you played the bigger
you got that one?
I've no, but right. I was in Into the Woods.
I love Into the Woods.
So I know I could do almost the whole show.
All right. Well, now we're going to move into general trivia. So these ones are just more general. No more the craziness there. We're going to go through some random ones and see. First question is, R&B sensation Deborah A. Cox reigned on Broadway in 2004 as this title African princess.
Bring it back, Aida. Right?
Yeah. Please bring it back.
Oh, I didn't hear you. Did she say it? She can have it.
When we Aida in 2004.
It was so upsetting. It was like a hit show. My uncle like got tickets. It's when you couldn't get a ticket. All I wanted to see was Heather Headley, and we get there and she's out. I start bursting in the lobby. It was so, but
huge scene.
Which is like now we support and love our understudies, but that's time I really wanted to see Heather Headley.
We have a request from Matt Casey. He says he needs a one-woman show of Into the Woods by Betsy. Yeah.
Oh, I'm game.
It's a good one.
That's perfect. All right. So, next question. Which composer was the first to EGOT? Ben?
I want to say Bobby Lopez.
That's not correct.
Oh,
Jenny Lauren.
Yeah, that won't be.
I'm gonna go with Stephen Sondheim.
Nope, Richard Rodgers.
Oh, I thought it was Winston. No, wow.
All right, next question: which screen-to-stage musical production had a special on MTV?
Oh,
screen-to-stage.
Ben,
Legally Blonde, right?
Legally Blonde, correct. Yeah.
Search for that. So my year at Boston Conservatory, there were like four girls that were on the reality show. And that is really good quarantine watching. If you haven't seen Search for the Next Elle Woods, where like the winner got to be Elle Woods. It's so good. You got to go down the YouTube rabbit hole. It's like the best trashy TV. But yeah, so I know it very well because all my friends were trying to be Elle Woods that year.
Oh my God. What was that? Denny said something?
They did that with Sandy from Greece too, right?
Yeah.
They did.
Yeah.
And that's how they found Laura Osnes.
Yeah. That's what, yeah.
Yeah. And that was how they found her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Wow. See, good things come out of trash TV.
There you go.
All right. Who originated the role of Velma Kelly in Chicago?
Ooh, wait. Yeah, Velma.
Oh.
Mark.
Yes.
Velma Kelly on Broadway.
Ben's hands up.
I want to see Gwen Verdon,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Or
was
she?
No, she was Roxy.
No. No,
the original, right? It was Gwen Verdon and Cheetah Rivera?
Frazier's wife.
It was Cheetah Rivera, right? No.
I'm going to take Laura's answer. You already got one. Laura, what was your answer?
It's Bibi New York.
No, it actually was Cheetah Rivera.
That's
my Tisha. No, she was in.
And then didn't Liza come in? Because I was watching Verdon, Fosse Verdon, right? And like, Cheetah did it. And then, it's so good, Brian. You would love it. Cheetah did it. And then I think Liza Minnelli came in for a little, I want to say.
Really?
Liza came in for Roxy.
Oh, for Roxy. See, I'm getting them all mixed up.
Who was the first Roxy?
Gwen. Yeah. Gwen Verdon.
That was right. Because
Right. Yeah.
Gwen and Cheetah.
I know we have that revival stuck in our head because that was Bibi New Earth and King. Yeah.
All right, just a few more questions here. We have Harry Connick Jr. donned sleepwear for the 2006 revival of this hit musical. Oh, Betsy? That was very close. Pajama Game is correct.
So good.
I love that show.
And see, moving on. When this musical was tried out before moving to Broadway, it was known as The Princess and the Pea. Jenny and Laura.
Once Upon a Mattress.
Once Upon a Mattress. You got a point.
Oh, yes.
Good. I love it. Next question. Which musical holds the record for the most Tony wins? Oh, Jenny?
The Producers?
That is correct.
Yes.
Good job, Jeff.
She got that over a producer, an actual producer.
Well, I was getting confused because did Hamilton tie or it got one less?
More nominations, but it didn't.
Yeah.
It's now not
possible. No, you're so right. Yeah, I think it tied with nominations, but producer.
I don't think you can ever reduce the categories.
Yeah, there was like
you win in every category now. I mean, I guess you could win it by getting more actors, but like you can't, it's almost impossible now to beat them. They're going to like go down in the history books.
They just have to add more.
Like, yeah.
I'm waiting for like a projection design award.
All right. Next question. Whose ghost supposedly haunts the Palace Theater?
What was that? I didn't hear
ghost
that.
Haunts the
Palace. Whose ghost supposedly haunts the Palace Theater?
The Phantom of the Opera.
No.
The literal Palace Theater? Oh, like yeah. I totally misunderstood the question.
Laura?
What do you call it? John Barrymore?
No.
You'd be at the Barrymore Theater.
I don't know. Literal.
Judy Garland.
Wow.
Really?
I didn't know that, so now I need to move into that.
I didn't know that either. That's awesome. I wonder if anything happened because Liza did her Liza at the Palace, so maybe like mom was.
I don't know.
Hanging out.
We have two more questions. The next one is Andrew Rannells originated which role in the Book of Mormon? Jenny.
Elder Price.
Elder Price is correct. Point for you. Nice. And the final question. The hills were alive with the sound of New Yorkers cheering when these crowd-pleasing productions tied at the Tonys for Best Musical in 1960. You need to get both.
Need to phone my dad.
Oh my God, phone a friend. Sam Simpson knows it.
So, Sound of Music.
Laura, yes. Go ahead. Laura?
I'm going to go. Should I say it? Mark, are you there?
Can we phone Chris Wilkes?
Well, let's.
Okay.
You can. Let's see.
Sound of Music and Fiorello.
They got it.
Yeah.
Wow. Well played.
That is a good.
All right. So what do we end the score with? Christy, let's hear the final scores.
The Silences with 6 and The Simpsons with 8.
There you go.
Oh. That was
fun.
That was really fun.
That was very good.
Thank you.
Sound of Music was written on the campus of Manhattan.
There's
more trivia. I love that.
Also, we just had a comment earlier that we needed to see.
Okay, that's fine.
That's
awesome.
As far as anyone needs to know, you at the same table. That's no one needs to know the final part of that story. That's fantastic. All right. So Jenny, Laura, Betsy, Ben, thank you so much. Chris in the background there.
Thanks
hello
for having us. Everyone's just
Bye.
Everyone go see Wit. Everyone buy a hoodie for me.
Exactly. Wit is again this Saturday. If you do not get your ticket yet, get your ticket for Wit on fairfieldcenterstage.org. Tickets are available for purchase now. Do not wait. Get your tickets now. Tell your friends. Tell everyone you know because we're still inside, you know?
Yes.
And by Saturday evening, you want to be back inside. Enjoy the daylight, but get back inside and watch the show because you don't want to miss this. All right, everyone, thank you so much. It was such a pleasure to see you. I loved having you here. We will be back for everyone next Tuesday. We'll be returning, and we'll have more guests for you, more surprise guests. You'll see later this week who the guests are that are joining us on the couch next Tuesday at 6 p.m. Until then, everyone, remember one very, very important thing. Wash your hands. Have a great night. Bye.
Bye. Bye.